to Science Friday. I'm Christy Taylor. As you might have guessed from the title of this event, we are going to talk about birds today. But not just any birds, the ones that died at the same time as the non-avian dinosaurs 65 million years ago. That's during what's known as the End Cretaceous mass extinction event. And if you don't remember it, that's right around the time when a big meteor hit the Earth. Dust blocked the sun, and 85%, that's 4 out of every 5 species, went extinct. That includes, again, the non-avian dinosaurs. But you know who made it, right? It was the mammals. That's why we're here. And the family of dinosaurs that gave rise to birds. In a lot of ways, we can think of this as a murder mystery. Maybe like Clue, but the mystery isn't who killed Mr. Body. It's why didn't Mr. Body, birds, die? It's an evolutionary mystery. What traits did birds' ancestors have that let them survive, stay alive, and keep evolving into the wondrous diversity that we see today? So here with me today, we're going to talk about that. And we're going to talk about that with two researchers who work together to study the existing evidence. And with the help of a brand new fossil skull, they have some ideas that the brain is involved. Let me welcome Dr. Julia Clarke, a professor of vertebrate paleontology at the Jackson School of Geosciences at the University of Texas at Austin. Julia, welcome back.
Thanks. It's great to be here.
Yeah, it's great to have you back. And Dr. Chris Torres, postdoctoral researcher in bird paleontology. He's at Ohio University in Athens, Ohio. Hey, Chris.
Hi, thanks for having me.
Yeah, welcome to the show. So Julia, we're going to start with you. I just described, again, what I would call the opposite of a murder mystery. We have a survival mystery here. Why don't you set up the scene of the crime for us, the anti-crime, the miracle? I don't know. What happened in this extinction event that makes survival so interesting, especially where birds are concerned?
Man, Christy, I could talk about that for like 5 hours, but we'll make it short and nuggety. I think it's really interesting to think, when we think of the question of why we have one group of dinosaurs that's still around with us today, and we lack all of these other species that are so charismatic and are all the dinosaurs that we probably grew up, you know, thinking about as a kid. But I think it's also important to think about all the other survivors. So the other major group, the cousins of the dinosaurs, these are the crocodilians, they also survive. Turtles survive. Lizards survive, right? So, and then we have mysteries like pterosaurs are gone. And pterosaurs are kind of interesting to think about because they're not birds, they're not dinosaurs. They evolve flight. They're around in some of the same environments as early dinosaurs that have taken flight, what we tend to think of as birds, but not the ones we have today. So we're going to have to parse that. But they're gone. They're gone by 66 million years ago. And they share a lot of problems with our murder mystery, our survivor mystery in birds, because they tend to not fossilize, not to be present in a lot of different fossil settings, in which fossilization occurs. So they tend to, what we're doing is we're trying to solve this survivor mystery, but with very limited data. And so we have to approach this question two ways, which you'll kind of see in the work that Chris has led on this new fossil, which is thinking, okay, what can we study? If we look at all our living birds today, these are the survivors and what they have in common, what is not present in the ones that go extinct? They're close cousins that flew, that are about the same body size, that also went extinct. And why do things that are very different, you know, stick around? So I hope that's like a little nugget. But actually, I'll throw one other thing out there, which
more
is
nuggets,
that we
please.
One other thing, yeah, which is that the fossils we still have to decode this mystery are very limited. And so every time we get a new insight, it shifts that picture a little bit. But what's so fun about this mystery is we still have a heck of a lot of hypotheses to rule out. And we have, you know, if we were at the murder mystery party, we would need, we still have, you know, Colonel Mustard and, you know, So we can, every new fossil gives us new important insight, but are we there yet? Or are the murders still occurring inside the house? I don't know. Maybe I took that metaphor too far, but that's my brief murder mystery summary.
Great. Well, thank you. I feel like this is an Inspector Clouseau or a Agatha Christie moment. Chris, why investigate the brain as a clue? Like, why is the brain the part that you wanted to focus on?
Yeah, so a couple of reasons. The really cop-out answer is because we could. For the longest time in the bird fossil record, especially of early birds, the brain has been effectively a black box. There's just been a complete total, almost total lack of data from that region for early birds. And this new fossil that we worked on finally preserved the data from the brain. And so we were able to tap into this really rich source of data that we hadn't been able to access before. But more substantially, it's because the brain is a really important organ for life, as one might expect. There's a lot about the way we live our daily lives that's tied to the brain. And so we can study the brain to gain a lot of really cool insights into how these organisms lived their lives. We're talking about organisms in the case of Ichthyornis, for example, kind of the star of our new paper, this early bird. It's 70, 80, 90 million years old. And so we're dealing with really precious and incomplete remains. And so we're looking for any kind of data that we can for insight into how the whole organism, when it was out living its life, was living its life. And the brain, at least the external shape of the brain, which is what we're really talking about here, is a really important source of information. And it's a really useful set of clues for reconstructing what these organisms were like when they were still alive.
Yeah, and how do you look at the, Chris, how do you look at the brain of an animal whose brain has not been fossilized? Because we don't have fossil brains here. We have skulls, right?
Right, yeah, exactly. So we're dealing with proxies for the brain. And so this is something that makes birds so convenient to study, because birds have really complex, gigantic brains. And part of what makes them so complex is that their skulls, just like in mammals, their skulls totally wrap around the external surface, the outside surface of the brain, which means that any given bird skull is effectively a mold for its brain, or at least the external surface. It's important to know we're talking about the outside, not the inside. So it gives us, it's basically a mold of the brain. And so if we have a particularly complete fossil bird skull, we can use that to reconstruct the outside of the brain and compare it to other extinct birds, near relatives of birds, non-avian dinosaurs, and living birds that we can go out and observe today.
Okay, so we found a skull. We are looking at skulls to interpret what the brain was shaped like. I think this is the part where we talk about what you found, right? So sure. You looked at, and you mentioned this bird Ichthyornis, and Julia or Chris, you know, either of you is welcome to jump in here, but you looked at this bird Ichthyornis and you compared that to modern birds. What did you see?
I'll let Julia introduce Ichthyornis because she's the leading expert on Ichthyornis. And there's no way I can describe it any better than
she. Well, I guess I'm maybe the OG Ichthyornis. There's plenty of people working on this animal now, but why is it so cool? So this was actually one of the earliest fossil birds that was described or known in detail shortly after Archaeopteryx, so within 20 or so years of Archaeopteryx. And Charles Darwin actually wrote to ornithologist Charles Marsh, the original describer of Ichthyornis, that's the genus of the species that we refer the skull to, Ichthyornis dispar, and he said, wow, what great evidence for evolution. It looks so close to living birds, but it has teeth. And that clearly means it's not part of a living species. So Darwin was so excited about this species back when it was described. And so you asked Chris about the brain, and I'll let him get into the brain here of Ichthyornis in a second. But what was important about Ichthyornis was that it was this very close cousin of the radiation of all the birds we have today. So that's like the common ancestor of all the birds we have today and all of its descendants. So Ichthyornis was a close cousin to that. In fact, it's the best represented in the fossil record of things that are close to that radiation. And that's why it was going to be so cool to finally get some insight into its brain. And that's, you know, back to you, Christy, or over to Chris.
Yeah, so ahead, Chris. so when it comes to their brain, so exactly why Ichthyornis is so interesting is why we're so fortunate to have this particular specimen, because it has a mostly complete skull, and that includes three-dimensionality, which is also a crucial aspect of this. It's not just that we have the parts, that we have them in position relative to where they would have been in life, which let us reconstruct most of the brain and compare it to a bunch of living birds, and then a relatively small sample, but it's the best we've got of early birds and near bird relatives. Early birds in this case really just refers to Archaeopteryx, which is the earliest known bird. It's and we had an idea of what its brain was like, and we had basically a total blank leading from Archaeopteryx to living birds. Ichthyornis filled that in. And so we had an idea of what the brain of Archaeopteryx and some more distantly related dinosaurs look like. And so we had an idea of why living bird brains, at least the external surface, why it was shaped differently from these other dinosaurs. And it there a lot of the differences revolved around the forebrain, the cerebrum. Living birds have enormous cerebral hemispheres, and those are a really major part, a really important part of the brain and how it works. The cerebral hemispheres are where a lot of higher cognitive functions occur, like it's where memories are stored, it's where learning happens, language is processed, senses are processed. So we knew there was a major difference between non-bird dinosaurs and living birds. Living birds have this enormous cerebral hemispheres, more distant relatives don't. A major question has been, where did that come from? Where along the line leading towards birds did that evolve? When did that first appear? When we looked at Ichthyornis, we found that its cerebral hemispheres were much more like Archaeopteryx and other non-bird dinosaurs, and very unlike living birds. It had relatively small cerebral hemispheres. And because Ichthyornis is so closely related to living birds, we were able to hypothesize that trait of having really large cerebral hemispheres probably was unique to living birds. And so it fit the pattern that Julia referenced earlier, which is we're looking for traits that are present in the survivors and absent in the casualties to try to help explain why the survivors survived. And so when we observed this state in Ichthyornis, this condition of having relatively small cerebral hemispheres, it indicated that having these large cerebral hemispheres fit that pattern and likely contributed in some way to the survivorship, to the exceptional survivorship of living birds through that end Cretaceous mass extinction event.
So Chris, and for people who are in our Zoom today, you get to see this, but we won't have this for our radio listeners. But I have this image that's sort of taken from your paper that shows, so Archaeopteryx, which is, you know, this oldest fossil, Ichthyornis, which is the fossil we're talking about today. And then we have bullfinches to stand in for all of the other birds that are still alive today. Sure. Like, tell us about what you see in these brains. Cause like, it's not just that the hemisphere, like the cerebrum is bigger. Sure. It's not that things are bigger. That's not the only thing.
Yeah. Right. So we're talking about a really fundamental change in shape here. And so it might not be super obvious what that change in shape really is. You can probably look at an image like this comparison between these early brains, these brains from early birds and living birds, and get an idea that there's something different, but it might not be obvious what that difference is. And a lot of it does revolve around expansion of the cerebrum, even though the effects are not just that the cerebrum is expanded. So the cerebrum in living birds is absolutely enormous. Relatively speaking, the other parts of the brain, when we're talking about the external shape, we see the cerebellum and the optic lobes, which are the hind and midbrain respectively. Those are proportionally much smaller, but also the position of those structures changes drastically, probably at least partially as a way of compensating for all of the space that the cerebral hemispheres are taking up in the skull. The skull, real estate is at a premium in the skull. And so if you're going to expand something, something else is going to have to give way. Something else is going to have to shift out of the way so that can happen. And so we see this general reshaping of the brain. So if you look at the brains of early birds, their brain is vaguely linear. You get one structure the cerebrum out front, the optic lobes or the midbrain in the middle, as might be expected by its name, and then the cerebellum is at the back. But in living birds, that is totally shifted, so that what was formerly the midbrain is now totally underneath what is formerly the forebrain. And so the change in shape is so fundamental that even those words are not very descriptive anymore. So we see this general reshaping that happens as a consequence of this relative expansion of the cerebral hemispheres.
Yeah, and I think also, like, one way I would describe, you know, in looking at the different images of brains is that the ichthyornis brain is almost like a train. You know, sure, it's like I see little train cars, mm-hmm, from the cerebellum to the at the back to the cerebrum, yep, at the front. But like, sure, the modern bird brain is much more just like a smushed thing. I don't know. It's folded, sure, and smushed. It's not very technical.
It's hard to describe. And that's an obstacle we faced in the paper itself. Like, mm-hmm, what's the most reasonable way and conservative way of describing the shape here without using words that mean something else?
Yeah.
It's a very abstract shape.
Well, and I want to get to what this shape might actually mean for, like, you know, we're talking about ichthyornis, which didn't make it, and we're, mm-hmm, talking about modern birds, which did. So, like, what about a brain shape like this might actually promote survival? What about the modern bird's brain shape? And Julia, also, I wanted to get to also this funny little thing at the front of the brain. I think it's called the vilst. I think that's how it's pronounced. And maybe that can tie in a little bit to what we're talking about with what modern birds have that ancient birds might not have, or the group of birds that died off weren't actually in possession of.
Sure. Yeah. So I can talk about what the expansion of the cerebrum might mean. The short answer is no. It's not super clear, right? So like I mentioned earlier, the brain is incredibly complex, right? There's so many functions associated with the brain. Just saying it's incredibly complex is an understatement. And so again, I want to emphasize that we're looking at the external surface of these brains. The brains themselves are three-dimensional structures. And so the neurons, the brain cells, are all below the surface. And it has to do with their organization and their connectivity and their density. That is where all of the cognition, all of the brain function actually happens. And so what we're looking for is some fossilizable feature, some feature in the fossils that gives some hint as to what's going on below the surface. And shape, relative size and shape of these structures hints at that. And so what this is telling us is that there's, of the myriad functions associated with the cerebrum, some or many or a few of those would have been linked to survival. Again, it's not clear what those functions actually were. It may never be clear what those functions are because the brain is so incredibly complex. And surface shape is so relatively simplistic, it may be that we're never able to directly say, okay, it's bigger, which means this. But it does help narrow down some functions that may be associated with that expansion of the forebrain. And if we can turn to modern neuroscience and look at bird brain researchers, looking at the actual functions of bird brains and comparing those to the brains in other reptiles, we start to get an idea of what those functions may have been, and we can start to hypothesize or at least speculate as to what the links would have been.
And Julia, let me throw you that question about the vilst one more time, which is, again, like, it's...
Well, I'm going to pick up here. So I think that the key thing to point out in kind of a context is that we actually have, as you get these fossils, these incompletely known fossils from the Mesozoic, of things that did not survive, to our knowledge, we don't know, no evidence they survived, right? They're more and more, we see more and more features that of their bony skeletons, of their soft tissues, fossilized remains of their soft tissues that are preserved, that are similar to living birds. We used to think that they all grew differently. That's been obscured by newer data that suggests there's something more complex going on. So in this context, it's very hard to find features that are unique to living birds. So for example, the loss of teeth, right? That happens a lot in close relatives, things that did not survive. So clearly, you know,
I want to break in here just and note, like, ancient birds had teeth, which not everyone here might know. Like,
So Ichthyornis has beautiful teeth, beautiful little teeth there. And, you know, it's this close cousin, and there are a couple of other cousins that have teeth, but then their cousins don't have teeth. And then that's happened like multiple times. So there are very few features we know are unique to living birds. And what Chris has described is something that we newly point out may be unique to those survivors. What it means in terms of like ecological flexibility, is it enhanced visual system? Chris might want to elaborate on this, but this is speculation at this point, because it's sort of like if you found a computer chip and that has a ton, it runs your whole phone, everything that your phone does. And you want to say, what's the reason my phone survived the break that's on this chip? I mean, it's a hard, because it's such a, it controls so much. It's involved in so many different pathways, the brain, like the forebrain alone in birds. So, you know, that's not an easily, that's why Chris went, you know, and it's unsatisfying to hear scientists say that. But what we also do is look at things, even including features of the brain that we can say are not unique to living birds and therefore are not likely candidates for why they survived. And one that you just mentioned is the vilst. So previously, the vilst was, it's a lump. You can see it on that picture of the bullfinch. It's like a ridge on the cerebrum. And Chris will get all excited talking about it. So it's on the upper side. You can see a little ridge there, and that's separating this vilst region of the brain. And this portion of the brain, which is neurons that you can't see that are not on the surface, but also the superficial kind of lump that's there. Those are involved in somatosensory integration, that is integrating like sensing and movement. We think they're important functions that have been described, like integrating sensory information and movement was thought to be really important in flight. And the first vilst was originally described in Archaeopteryx. It was later shown that that was a crack on the surface of the skull that was implying its possible presence. Those authors were not definitive. So, and then what we found is evidence in where we can clearly see there is no break, no crack of something consistent with the presence of a vilst in this guy who goes extinct, Ichthyornis. And so that's what we can do, is rule out a feature that people previously thought might be key to survivorship, might be indicating something about movement, about sensory ecology, that is now in species that went extinct. So what we're trying to do is narrow it down, right? Like, can we get at hypotheses that need to be explored further and those that don't seem particularly viable on their own? And I don't know if we're ready to go there, but we also looked at body size as another hypothesis that had been put forward. So back to you, Christy.
Thank you. And I'm going to stop sharing this image now.
Oh, but... sorry, because I used the image to explain what the vilst was.
No. So I'm ready for everyone to see my sweaty face again. We're actually going to go to a listener question now, because we have so many really great ones. And I'm going to start with Candace from Arizona, who, and this is more of a brain question, so we'll see how we feel about talking about it. Candace, if you're able to unmute yourself, go ahead and ask that question.
Yes, thank you. This is a great program. I'm interested in your research and whether it shows if the ancestors of today's birds had the ability for their bird to change rapidly when there was a changing environment, such as what we have with climate change right now. Birds are arriving places without having adequate nutrition and so on. So that's my question. Thank you.
That is a great question. Julia or Chris, does either one of you feel more eager to answer it?
So the answer is yes. So The conditions, so I think in terms of rapid climate change, right? Global, rapid, catastrophic climate change is thematically similar to what we're seeing, what we would have seen then and what we're seeing now. Causes obviously vastly different. But yeah, so the environment was changing incredibly rapidly. And so like Julia indicated, there's all these functions that would be associated with the cerebral hemispheres, these higher cognitive functions, so to speak. And so all of these functions, or at least some of these functions, may have been associated with behavioral plasticity, the ability for the organisms that had those organs, the ancestors of living birds, to have a wide repertoire of possible behaviors, or wider and more plastic, more changeable, more adaptable than their co-evolved species, other species that would have been around at the time, which would have conceivably, potentially have prepared them for rapidly changing environments. And so we might have expected to have seen this plasticity in a wide range of behaviors, whether it is migration, moving across the world, where they're feeding, when they're feeding, what they're feeding on, learning new behaviors. So basically modifying their own behavior as the world is rapidly changing. I think that got into your question. Julie, do you have anything to add to that?
Well, I think it's an interesting question. I was just reading a question in the chat that was sort of around the same thing. And what we can't parse is whether the survivors are, as Chris alluded to, perhaps have ecological differences, mm-hmm. that then creates natural selection for larger brains, or if larger brains have evolved and that behavioral flexibility, if we are very vague about it, mm-hmm. precedes the actual extinction event.
Right.
So oftentimes what we have is that you, for example, you can't have natural selection for a more, let's say, efficient wing until you have the natural selective force of moving in air. And so this can be a difficult thing to parse in terms of cause, like mm-hmm. the brain would, which is responding, is there something that leads to, you know, overall larger size? And this comes up a lot in human evolution debates, for example. But it's a really good question on the part of several of our listeners. I hope that we both partially answered it.
Well, and I think actually this is a great point, a great time to sit back and ask the question that I hate and love to ask, but which is, who cares? Like, why would it matter why Ichthyornis didn't make it and all of these other birds and their ancestor did? Like, does it change anything about the world that we inhabit today?
Yeah, because it's happening again, right? Like, we're in a mass extinction. It's happening right now. And so a lot of research, rightfully so, is focused on, you know, how do we stop this? How do we fix this? But I think a lot of research needs to focus on what's the world going to look like afterwards, assuming we can stop things, assuming that we can do something to rein in what we're doing. How do we predict what the world is going to be like? And a lot of that revolves around who's going to be around when this is all done. And by understanding that, by understanding what traits influence survivorship, we can make really informed scientific decisions about, for example, conservation. It helps us to figure out, okay, we're spending money. Where do we spend that money? And what science is going to influence our decision-making when it comes to that? And so by understanding these traits in birds, by understanding comparable traits in all of the other lineages that survived, we get an idea of what traits influence survivorship. We can help, we can start to make predictions about which organisms may be successful. And if they are successful, how are they going to change? What's going to change about them going forward? And so we only get those insights by looking at how it's happened before. And so insights like these are those insights.
Is it oversimple, like looking at these comparisons of brains, to say that smarter animals are probably more likely to make it?
Gosh, that is such a great question, because I always think about crows. So I end my class at UT talking not about, we do human evolution, and then I talk about crows. And because I think that we too often emphasize the peculiarities of our own intelligence and not that of our co-travelers on this planet who look very different from us. And crows and ravens have been, where I grew up in California, have been expanding their range so enormously. And there are so many amazing videos you can watch of crows and ravens really and read scientific studies of their adaptability in human modified environments. And they are the biggest brained of our survivors. So parrots and corvids, the crows and ravens, have the absolutely largest brain per body size of any of our extant birds. And it doesn't mean survival of the smartest necessarily, but we do see a lot of adaptability in these large brain species to human modified environments, which is most of the Earth at this point. So I think that's a really interesting point that Chris made. And I also want to plug that what we're seeing now and trying to understand in real time, we're looking back, you know, 66 million years through a dirty lens at incomplete data. And so, of course, all my colleagues who are extant conservation biologists are like, we're studying this in real time now, you know? But I think that this extinction event so fundamentally reshaped our terrestrial ecosystems, our forest environments, all of the things that were shifting right around 66 million years ago. Our world would look very different without this, you know, stochastic, this mass extinction event that just boom, shifted everything. So in some ways, it's a good reminder of the stochasticity of these events and how they've short-term events have completely reshaped the Earth system. And what we're doing is kind of trying to make sense of how exactly that worked. Because identifying causal features or causal factors in survivorship and extinction is really difficult to do. Mm-hmm. And yeah, so.
I actually want to piggyback off something that Julia just said, which is dead on, which is that the human-centric human-centric notion of intelligence and smartness. And I think it's important to remember that any trait that influences survivorship is entirely contextual. And so what we call smart starts to lose meaning when we're talking about things that are increasingly further removed from us, right? So fish, what we consider intelligence, starts to unravel when we're looking at fish, let alone insects, let alone plants. Right, that it's not even a term that's really applicable to plants, and yet they're wildly successful all over the world.
It is. You know, I was part of a little working group which was so fascinating on non-neural intelligence, and so what problem solving looks like without neurons. So right. That's another way that we've been very human-centric in this idea of a motherboard and controlling motor function, right? And there are other organisms. If we broaden our view to the ways that decision-making is occurring in even non-neural organisms, is super fascinating. Also not what our paper's about, but very interesting.
Chris, did you want to finish that thought?
I think that's dead on. I think that's exactly right. Yeah, I think this traditional human notion centric of intelligence and smart you've got to shift it as you start to expand what you're looking at and get a better idea of, you know, the different ways things can be intelligent or smart. And we start looking away from, you know, just behaviors that we could imagine a human doing.
Julia mentioned cause and effect, which I think is actually really related to a question we have from one of our listeners, from John, who's asking whether a harsher environment basically could have affected dinosaur brains. John, I don't know if you're still here, but if you want to unmute and maybe articulate your question yourself, go for it. You're still muted.
Is that John Malee?
Malee, yeah, sorry. I believe so. You're asking about the bottleneck and
yeah,
okay.
Well, it's a very simplistic question. I realize that maybe being smart, I think that if a species, right, it goes through a very difficult environmental environment, so they're short of food or their security is threatened, To put it simply, I'm not a scientist, but they're going to have to get smart if they're going to survive. And anybody who's been around crows when I was a kid, I remember being around crows a lot. They're incredibly smart. I mean, really, really. And without any scientific studies to back it up, I've seen them myself and I've been around them for hours and days. So that was basically my question, that could that possibly have resulted that the birds that did survive had gone through such difficult times, either through security or food shortages, that they just had to evolve their brains to survive. And they're only those survived of that species. And therefore, when the asteroid came or meteorite, that the others just didn't make it because they hadn't evolved as much. It's very simplistic.
You know, John, it's not simplistic at all. You know, so it's really fascinating, the parallels. And I'm sorry, Christy, I just jumped in there.
Yeah, go for it.
Because I was thinking about human evolution. And so we now know that a lot of major shifts in the hominid lineage were preceded by a much more variable climate. And the timescales of these things are probably fairly different. And the nature of the change after, you know, an asteroid impact versus essentially like rapid cycling into interglacial cycles, you know, like, but climate variability has been something that's been discussed with respect to drivers of hominid evolution. I like to say the other bipedal large-brained group on the planet besides birds, that's us, you know, bipedal, large brains, you know, binocular vision. We got a lot in common with plenty of bird species, independently evolved, by the way, we're not close cousins. But I think the idea of climate variability, for example, one hypothesis that I've broached earlier is that what we have found rather surprisingly, and Chris was a member of this team, in Antarctica is that all of the fossils we find from right before the extinction event are all part of living bird groups. So groups we still have around today. And as you go back in time in Antarctica, actually, to the much more temperate or much more, right, like not the latest Maastrichtian, you find other groups that are these cousins, these non-survivor groups. And so it's interesting also to think that whether these groups, if they're already inhabiting regions with, you know, 3 to 4 months of total darkness, and are there traits that are evolving in these most extreme of Earth's, you know, environments, is that somehow connected? And so I think it's a really great question, John, and not at all simplistic. And it is something that a lot of people have been thinking about with regards to different groups.
We have one anonymous question that I'm just going to read for the questioner. And their question is, looking at hummingbirds and hawks, one wonders about the cerebellum and its role in balance during flight. Is there evidence of changes that led to backward flight in hummingbirds or rapid descent as we see in raptors?
Yeah, so that question is one that we would love to be able to answer. So that gets at associating function with external shape, which is it's really non-trivial and it's really difficult. Like I mentioned earlier, and I keep stressing, right, the brain is really complex. And so a change in shape, a change in relative size, relative volume or mass, can have cascading effects, right? They can affect, probably do affect every function associated with that shape. But because brains are so incredibly complex, you can have really major, you could have really major neuronal change, major changes at the cellular level, which affect the functions of the brain with possibly no appreciable change at the superficial level. You could conceivably have really major changes below the surface with no change at the surface, which means that we may not have any direct evidence for that shift in function and any associated shifts in behavior. And so trying to constrain that, get an idea of how much neuronal change can there be? How much neurological change, how much behavioral change can there be before you start to see meaningful changes, observable changes in the shape of the brain, is a direction of research that lots of labs around the world, including some in Julia's lab and some research that I'm pursuing, revolve around trying to answer that question. Number one, you know, how much change can there be before you start to see it at the surface? Number two, how much surficial change do you see? And number three, can you go backwards, right? Once you see that change in structure, can you make a meaningful connection? Ideally, you can. To the changes in behavior, changes in function, changes in neurology that preceded that shift.
Yeah, Julia.
I thought it was a great answer from Chris. I just wanted to add to it. Of course, there are groups that try to study this by, like, you know, PET scans of different brain regions, like what's involved in a living bird brain to make when a behavior occurs, right? But because birds are not closely related to humans, then the amount of funding for that kind of research is much more limited. So I am with you, whatever, I forgot the name of our caller.
They were anonymous.
Anonymous, I'm with you. I would love to know what is going on in the brain, just in a living bird brain, regardless of whether we can see its shape, you know, what region or whether it would be manifest in a fossil, that is associated with these behavioral shifts. In the case of a kind of flight pattern or a particular kind of movement, it may be, as Chris alluded to, something that would not manifest in a major shape change that we would find in a fossil. But I do also want to say that the way we are studying this is we want to look at closely related species. So to see how fast can the brain shape evolve? And that's what Chris is directly involved in studying now, is like, so if a totally new feeding behavior occurs within the last million years or less, like on what are geologically tiny timescales, how much shift in the shape of the brain occurs? And that is, I think, the necessary next step that he's pursuing, and we're pursuing, to look at that, to start answering these questions that we can bring to the fossils in deep time.
I think that brings me to one of my last questions, which is actually we'll start here. Is there anything fossils themselves can't tell us about why animals survive these mass extinction events, and how birds have been evolving in this time?
So I'm gonna let Julia start.
The fossils can't tell, there's a lot that we do not have in our fossils, right? We don't have the whole insides. We don't have, you know, what were their lungs like? Mm-hmm. I mean, what we're looking for is fossilizable correlates, things that can enter the rock record. And those are generally mineralized tissues like bones or teeth or, the tight wrapping of the brain, right? So those are things that we get fairly regularly when we have a fossil. So everything else, you know, we don't have. I think the big question with the extinction event is also where our fossils come from. We need a global record. We can't just know what happened in North America. And almost everything that we know about extinction comes from North America. And so we need a global perspective. And that's the reason that we've been trying to get new data from the farthest conceivable regions, from the impact site, which was in Mexico, present day Mexico, to see what's happening there, right? And I think the other challenging thing, the thing that we may, you know, we're getting a lot of new proxies for, like, okay, what was the first day like? You know, they like my colleagues at UT here drilled the crater itself. How fast does life come back? We are learning new things about really core questions related to extinction, but there are so many to ask. So if you know any budding paleontologists out there, there is a lot still to learn about this particular event and extinction in general.
And then I think then the last question is just, Julia, you refer to this need for a global fossil record, but like what kind of fossil find, you know, as you sort of scour the globe, both of you, would kind of change the game for you? Like what is your dream in terms of answering these questions we've been discussing? Chris, why don't you go first?
Yeah, so I want more brains. I just want more brains.
So you're the zombie in the room.
I'm the zombie in the room, yeah. It's having really nice skulls, which would be great for 1,000 different reasons. But so having this one specimen, this new specimen of Ichthyornis, threw so much light on the extinction of most dinosaurs and helped us understand so much how and why living birds were the only dinosaurs that we know of that survived. But the grand total of early bird brains that we now have data on has gone from 1 to 2, which is still incredibly tiny. If we're gonna have a second brain, if we're gonna have two brains, the earliest known bird and then arguably the closest relative of living birds are the two best ones to have. But there are so many other species out there that we don't have data for. And each of those species could represent a totally unheard of, unpredicted brain shape that could give us all of this insight into how those organisms were living their lives and what the environment was like, what the ecosystems were like. Having more brains would help us fill in the context within which the ancestors of living birds were living when this extinction happened. And so I just want more really nice complete skulls so I can have their brains.
I'm hearing you. You're saying we could even find a skull that completely trashes, in scientific terms, everything that you're proposing in this paper.
Oh yeah, absolutely. Yeah, that's true of every paper. And I think it's really important for authors especially to acknowledge that it's conceivable that there's data we could collect that could totally trash our hypotheses. And so what we did in this paper was we had the newest and the broadest source of data yet published, because we were able to build off of everybody who came before us and provide something new. And that gave us some new perspectives on what may have happened and helped us refine some hypotheses, reject others. And so more data could totally change the game. And so I want those data, whether they change the game or not, I want those data.
Julia, what do you want?
Well, first of all, I want to say in science, we don't proceed by trashing. Like, there's not a lot of trashing going on. And so
that was an inelegant term of
I was imagining, like, okay, say someone found a new brain tomorrow and Chris is hungry like a zombie for this brain. Mm. What would it show? It potentially could be a brain from a species that goes extinct that has an extant avian style brain, in which case we would have to say, well, that alone doesn't explain the extinction. Mm-hmm. That would be the closest to trashing if we wanted to go that way. But the other possibility is that we find this species that has a brain like that of living birds, and we know that it goes extinct and it evolved that independently. And, you know, what would that mean? Maybe that, were there shared selective pressures? Somebody asked about in the Q&A about pterosaur brains, and there are some shared commonalities that we see in the early flyers, things we've referred to as not the birds we have today, but the earliest flyers. And so there does seem to be some convergent shaping of certain aspects of the brain. And it also happens in other dinosaurs. We have like other overwrapped torosaurs, for example, some very bird-like, not what we're reporting, but like some shifts in that direction, if you will. So it's, it'll definitely be interesting to see what we find next. What do I want? Well, I think I'd like to find from a really nice, well-calibrated, dated, you know, sequence in Antarctica, just tons of complete bird skeletons, including skulls for Chris, that illuminates diversity in a much fuller way before and after the extinction event. And I'd love to know what that recovery is like. But I think we need not just Antarctica, we need this from a lot of other places around the world. And so that takes time to get there and the ability to to for people to get in the field again.
I am picturing a Secret Santa gift exchange in which Chris just gets tons of skulls. So thank you for that.
I'm also expecting that. So.
Well, thank you both so much for joining me. We are out of time. We have gone longer than I could have ever dreamed in such a wonderful way. So thank you both for joining us today.
Thanks for having me.
Yes, thank you. It was such a pleasure to be with you all. And there's so many questions. So, you know, find us at another event and come talk to us and ask all of those lovely questions. So thank you guys for having us.
Ask us on Twitter. We love.
Oh, we have have Twitters. Chris is what is it? Torosaurus Rex?
Yes. Torosaurus. Torosaurus Rex.
I bet we could find a way to share that.
And
on
I'm Julia Clarke Paleo Lab, right, Chris? Never one for short.
Right.
Yeah. So you can tweet at us. All right.
Please tweet at them. Well, thank you both so much again. Julia Clarke is a professor of vertebrate paleontology at the Jackson School of Geosciences. That's at the University of Texas in Austin. And Chris Torres is a postdoctoral researcher studying bird paleontology and their brains at the University of Ohio in Athens. Thank you everyone so much for joining us today. I'm Christy Taylor.